We are running short of time, as Dr. Biju has rightly pointed out. We have three tracks, and we are on to the first track. The first track time allotted is from 10 a.m. to 12 noon, but now it is 10:30. So approximately we have 90 minutes. We have nine research papers lined up. So I think I'll put it like this. We can have roughly around 10 minutes maybe for presentation, and a couple of questions, if any, from the participants, and then we'll move on to the next paper. So the paper presenters can focus on what is their title, the key objectives, and what are their major findings as it is related or integrated with the objectives. So if you can fine-tune your presentation on that line, that would be excellent. So I welcome my co-chair, Professor Hemal Pandya. Before we start, I invite her to give her views. If this is okay with her, we can proceed. Madam, you have got something to add, you can add. Otherwise, Professor Hemal, you are online. Professor Hemal Pandya, if you are there online, you can, in anything that you would like to add or put as remarks.
Hemal ma'am, are you there in the meeting? Yeah. Ma'am, can you add something?
Want to add something? You can give your remark before we start off.
Ma'am, you are muted. I think the voice is not clear.
Ma'am, you are still on mute. We cannot hear you. You're not audible, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay.
Ma'am, we think you are still not audible.
Can you check your headset, or else you can remove the headset and talk, because the problem with the headset, I think so. Ma'am, it's not audible.
She's moving into mute mode. It's showing as mute.
Yeah, unmute also. Yeah, ma'am. Now it's audible.
I think it's audible now.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Very good morning to all. And I completely agree with the chairperson. Because of the lack of time, we can follow the rules which he has made, and we can continue with the session.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. So we'll invite the first paper. The title of the paper is Water Quality Estimation of MCS, based on the gold features. Paper is jointly authored by Dr. Samna and Dr. A.R. Sardar from Al Gharyar, Dubai, UAE. So I invite the paper presenters to introduce themselves and start off with the presentation. Thank you.
Yes.
Good morning, Aug, and myself sharing the screen, and my co-author will start the presentation.
Okay.
Am I audible to all?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
You can see the presentation right now?
Coming up, yeah. Now it's
yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now it's visible.
Okay. Dr. Samna will start the presentation.
Good morning to all, and welcome to my presentation on volatility estimation of MCX gold futures with Gauss model. Myself, Dr. Samna M., Assistant Professor of Commerce, Iqbal College, Periyamala, and my co-author is Dr. A.R. Sardar, Head of Financial Risk Management, Al Ghurair, UAE. All of us know the history of derivative trading in India. From early civilization, trading in commodities are in the lifeblood of economic activities. Similarly, gold, silver markets evolved in classical civilization. Chicago Board of Trade formed in 1848 in USA, but in India, organized the commodity trading started with the introduction of Bombay Cotton Trade Association in 1875. But in some point of time, India banned the commodities trading in most essential commodities with the introduction of regulatory body as Forward Market Commission. Futures trading also allowed in India in the later 2003. That regulatory body is now merged with SEBI from 2015. And move to the statement of the problem. As we know, the investment in gold is considered more safe and secure, and its volume in bullion segment shows major share and importance. Greater participation from trading community. What was this study of volatility behavior of gold futures with multi-commodity exchange? Then we have to consider the objectives of the study. The first one is volatility behavior of, to find out the volatility behavior of M6 futures. And second one, first fit among GASH and GJR GASH models, and also trying to understand the impact of exogenous factors on price volatility. Then move to data and methodology for this paper. Daily closing price of M6 gold futures prices from February 2009 to December 2020 taken for analysis. This include normally 3133 observations, and it is in the form of time series data. And the methodology used for this analysis, time series analysis, and augmented Dickey Fuller test, that is RDF, conducted to test the stationarity of data, and Jacobera goodness of fit test for normality, and volatility of price data was estimated through GASH model. Then fitted the Glaucian, Jagannathan and Rangel GASH, that means the GJR GASH model also. Right. Now I am handed over the presentation to my co-author, Dr. Sadar Ayar, for presenting the analysis part.
Thank you, Dr. Samna. Am I audible, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Moving into the review of the literature, the volatility clustering in financial markets, the first study was come out in 1963 by Mandelbrot. Later on, in 1986, and Nelson and Boleslaw was studied, the volatility estimation can be achieved and estimated through the our classical models like Arch and Gage. And later on, the Engel and Breslau again in 1987, there were more discussions on the estimation process. The critical thing is the error term distribution to identify it's the proper error term distributions. And Awatani and Koradi done some studies on the S&P 500 indices, and they come out with there is the standard GASH and E-GASH models are outperforming in certain time series, especially the financial data. And Bekaskov in 2019, the E-GASH with student speed distribution, they have done some studies on the Macedonian stock exchanges, and they were critically pointed out the distribution is very key, and identifying the distribution of the model is very key in estimating the volatility. And Winston in 2014 come out with the GGR GASH model with student distribution in Nordic indices in European markets has given out a clear enlightening of the importance of the GGR GASH model and the distribution to estimation of the volatility. In our study, what we are trying to do is the estimation of the volatility with a GASH variant, especially focusing on the standard GASH model and GGR GASH model. GGR GASH model is Glaston, Jagannathan, and Runkel. They've come out with a small modification of the model and more focused on the distribution of the residuals and error terms. And moving into the analysis and discussion, as we all know that if you're dealing with the time series data, it is the primary thing is to check the stationarity of the data. We have done the unit root test, is the most classical test is the ADF, augmented Dickey Fuller test, and you can see the statistics and the p-value. So we have rejected the null hypothesis, and we taken the first, you know, as the, since the time series data is price information, we have taken the first lag of the return series, and return series is perfectly giving. You can see from that graph, it's stationary, and the histogram also following certain kind of a normality. and the p-value and test statistics are showing that data is normal and stationary. Then the next one is a normality test. And standard deviation of the data of the return will give an idea about the volatility. It is showing that the MCX stock prices, the gold futures prices are very volatile in nature, and their skewness and the kurtosis will imply more enlightening on the behavior of the price data. And we have done the Jack and Barrett test for the normality. The test statistics is there, the p-value, and the p-value inferred to a not a normal distribution. So that is a very challenging point to us to do the Gauss model fitting. So moving into the Gauss model, before that, I will just point out on volatility clustering. See, this is the original data, the time series data of 11 years in the Indian market. It is a very highly volatile. It is starting from below 2000 and ending up to around 5000, 6000 levels in a 10 year span. So we have calculated the standard deviation, and we come out with a annualized standard deviation of the data, that is a square root of 252. 252 is the number of days trading in a market. So it's come out to be the 15.15 of the annualized volatility of the gold prices. And we extracted using our program the MCX gold futures volatility on monthly basis. This is the kind of a volatility clustering, because there is a big change in the price data followed by small change, big change followed by the small change. This is the way the commodities or the any financial instruments work in the market. We extract it using the R program, this kind of a monthly volatility and annualized volatility. So you can see the pattern change and regime change in the price with respect to the macro and microeconomic factors or fundamentals. Now I'm moving into the Gauss model, and we try to do the Gauss model with a normal distribution as the first. You can see the mean model is Afrina, and the distribution, error term distribution, is a normal, and the p-values are satisfactory. And we're coming into the Box-Jung test, that is a serial correlation, and it's inferring that there is a kind of a serial correlation exist in the data. Mm-hmm. And moving into the goodness of fit, that is the adjusted Pearson goodness of fit test, that is giving us very small p-values, that is inferring towards a more scope of improvement in the model. So then we try to change the distribution. Before going into the distribution, I will enlighten you with the plot details. So these are the tall plots coming with the Gauss. If you run with R model with UGauss package, you will get this tall, very illustrative graph. This is the first graph is the two conditional standard deviation superimposed with the return, and it is giving, this is the two standard deviation in the red line, and it is giving. So here you can see there are a lot of kind of outliers, and this is the 1% value at risk against the return. It is also showing that some of the point of time it's already the returns are breaching the value at risk level. This is the conditional standard deviation versus return. This is a blue line is the conditional standard deviation, and this is the return. And the fourth one is the autocorrelation of the observations. So the autocorrelation of the observation, this is the line, is the important line. It is breaking because there is a kind of a autocorrelation in the data. And squared autocorrelation function of the squared observations and the absolute observations are same towards the inference towards the autocorrelation behavior, and correlation squared was absolute observation is also giving. And this histogram I previously shown, the distribution is somewhere in the normal distribution, but it is not very clear. But it is evident that from this graph of the QQ plot, this is a normal line, and this is the data distributed in the return series that is giving upper side and the lower side. The data has a lot of outliers, and it's a kind of a thick tail in the data. So it's a thick tail means it's a risky, and there is a tail risk is involved in that particular data. So this is an autocorrelation function of the residuals, and the residuals is somewhere in, having minimized, because with the residuals, we have taken the first lag of the information, and we have done that model, and that residuals giving somewhere around that. And the last one is the news impact curve. News impact curve is one of the output coming from this UGARCH model that is giving the symmetry of exogenous factors, especially the news, towards the price volatility clustering. So the graph is a pretty clear parabola. So that is giving an inference that the information flow to the respect to the this model estimation of volatility is symmetric in nature. There is no biasness in that. So then I move into the standard skewed students t distribution, because we are considering the distribution. Yeah, distribution is standard, and here the p value is very higher, so we rejected it. So then moving into the GGR-GARCH model and students t distribution, so here it's almost fitted from the p value, and we can go with the this model. And importance is, I'm not moving into the details, you can see the normal distribution is improved a lot, as well as the autocorrelation function. But if you're coming into this news impact curve, it is somewhere towards the one sided. That means there is some information impact is there in the data. So I'm moving into my conclusion and suggestions. So from the study and the GARCH model fitting, there is a small gain or few significant losses which could lead to the high risk and return and the chance of the higher return. And it this kind of all the behavior of that particular data or the volatility will fully captured using the GGR-GARCH model, that is evident from that. And the another inference that is towards the objective of the study, find out the exogeneity of exogenous factors on the price behavior, there is that is shown from the last curve, that is giving the positive news will take us into an increase in the volatility compared to the negative news. Negative news has more favor towards the high volatility in the market rather than the positive. So these are the references we used for that. If the short of time of this time as well as the slide, I short down the only important things. So that's all on our presentation. Thank you
Dr. Sabna and Dr. Sardar for your wonderful presentation. Now before we come into our comments, anybody among the participants who would like to raise a couple of questions on the presentation, you can do that now. Anybody wants to, who have observed the presentation, which was a wonderful presentation on futures, gold futures, and its movement using the GARCH model. So anybody would like to raise anything?
If you want to have any questions further, you can note it down the contact details. If you are not time limitation, yes, you can contact us.
Can I have a question, please?
Sure.
Can I have a question, please?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Sir, you have applied the GARCH model, but data seems to be, why not you applied eGARCH and ARCH model in that time series data?
So ARCH model is one.
Why particularly GARCH model?
Because the GARCH variant are more evident, because the number of coefficient in the GARCH and ARCH model, there is a beta coefficient is very relevant if you are estimating something on the conclusivity. You know, the conclusivity of the result is more in GARCH compared to the ARCH model. ARCH model have mu, alpha and gamma. There are three coefficients are there in the output. But if you go with the GARCH model, there is a beta is there, alpha. There we are getting a four coefficient that will conclusivity of the model is very important. And if you talk about the GARCH model and whatever the literature I reviewed, all the past data is showing that the GARCH model, standard GARCH model and GGR-GARCH model are more prevalent in estimating the market volatility if you're comparing in a very large sample of data. Okay, that's the reason we gone into the GARCH model, standard GARCH model and GGR-GARCH model.
But you have analyzed the returns, but after analyzed, you have taken the log returns.
Of course, because it's a primary data, the first time data is the price data, right? If price data, if you plot it, it has all the anomalies like seasonality and
okay.
Trend.
You cannot do that. You have analyzed it, so okay. Yes, yeah. You analyzed it, then why you have gone for log returns? Once you
There are two things we need to address. If you have a data, you need to, especially the time series data, you need to take it in two phases, okay? You need to avoid the spurious regression, the spurious regression of the data. If the data is not stationary, if whatever you come out with, it is meaningless because the data is highly correlated with seasonality and trend and everything. So first of all, you need to take out that trend and the seasonality and behavior. You need to do the stationarity checking and you need to take a proper log returns, first lag or second lag or whatever it is. Normally in all time series data, especially in the modeling process, if you take a return, either log return or yesterday's price minus today's price divided by the yesterday's price,
yes,
is a normal, you get the data to be ready for your further analysis. That is to completely avoid the spurious regression. You call it as in the regression analysis, spurious regression. Otherwise, whatever you come out with, it is a meaningless. So it's very important that you have done a proper data cleaning process.
Thank you, Mr. Sardar.
What software do you use? Do you use DeepView?
No, we are using the R. Normally in my studies, I use R and Python. That is more advanced. It's very comprehensive and pre-platform.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you. Madam, do you have anything to add, or shall we call the next presenter?
Yeah, congratulations to both the authors. Very good presentation as well as very good research study. So far as the techniques are concerned, you have applied the latest models and that. So actually, I want to congratulate both of you. Very good.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, Simon, sir. Thank you, madam.
Thank you,
everyone.
Thank you so much for this opportunity.
By the way, I'm not an academician. I am working as a corporate professional in financial risk management.
Very good.
So this is my sister. It's my sister. She's working with the Kerala University. And we jointly did this project.
Thank you. Thank you. Because we are running short of time and quickly rushing through, the next paper is on what is slackening the growth of student-managed investment funds in India. This is the title of the paper. The paper is presented by Alfie Maria Joseph, Jerin Jose, and Anusha Srinivas Iyer, all from Christ Deemed to be University, Bangalore. So over to you for the paper presentation.
Simon, sir. I think there is one paper in between, that is Price Discovery and Volatility Spillover Relationship Between Spot and Future Market by Rukhvinder, Katosh and Shilpa from lovely professional
people. The track that has been shared to me shows this as a second paper. No problem, you can invite because I don't see the other paper.
Okay, sir. So over to Shilpa, ma'am, for your presentation on Price Discovery and Volatility Spillover.
Okay, ma'am, thank you.
You can introduce yourself, because I don't find this paper, the track with me. So you can just introduce yourself and start.
Yes, sir. Good morning to everyone. I, Shilpa, research scholar at Lovely Professional University, under the supervision of Dr. Rupinder Katoch, associate professor at Lovely Professional University, wants to present my topic on price discovery and volatility spillover between spot and future market, a review of recent literature. Firstly, I'll explain the key terms of my paper, that is spot market, future market, volatility spillover, and price discovery relationship. Spot market is that market where the exchange of future instruments settle immediately. And future market is that where contract between two parties settled at a future date. And the next term is volatility spillover, that is made of two words, volatility and spillover. Volatility is a synonym with the measure of risk, or you can say uncertainty. Volatility describes the difference from an expected value. In stock parlance, rapid price fluctuation in either side or either direction is considered as volatility. Spillover of volatility is deviation in one country's stock market may affect the other country's stock market. It may be cross, it may be own. Own means when it is influenced by its own event. Cross means when it is influenced by the events of other markets. The next important term here is price discovery, that is explained with the help of two models, that is cost of carry model, which means fair future price depends upon this model. Fair future price depends upon the spot price, and it is deferred in case of carryable asset and in case of non-carryable asset. In case of non-carryable asset, we can say that it is a difference of risk-free interest and dividend received, and on the basis of expectancy model, the fair future price depends upon the sentiments of the investor, whether it may be bearish or bullish. The next part is theoretical framework. according to the first theory of information asymmetry in capital market, one person has more information as compared to other information. This concept is firstly used by Ekalov in 1917 in his first research paper. And according to the second theory, that is a random walk theory, according to this theory, future price do not depend upon the past prices. This theory is developed by Morris Kinder in 1953. He said that there is no relationship between the present and the future stock price. Now the next very important theory, that is a wavelet theory. According to this theory, time series data are in the raw form. So we have to process it through mathematical transformation, because no information can be derived from the unprocessed time series data. These raw data are to be transformed into final processed signals so that meaningful information should be derived from this. According to this theory, the important part, that is a frequency, that is hidden. As you can see in this picture, the first two pictures is of stationary data and the third one is of non-stationary data. It is very easy to find out the frequency in case of stationary data. But in case of non-stationary data, when low frequency data is mixed with the high frequency data, so it is difficult for us to find out the frequency part. So it will be possible with the help of wavelet decomposition. Because wavelet decomposition, what it will do, it will bifurcate, it will decompose the data into the low frequency, into the moderate frequency, into the high level frequency. As the need of my research problem is, traditionally, in the conventional, while forecasting the hierarchical time series data, high frequency series are mixed with the low frequency series. Frequency part has been ignored according to this wavelet theory. And the next important part is, in the previous literature, what they have done, the term spillover and contagion is mixed. Otherwise, both have different meanings. As we can see, contagion means that we have to study the impact of negative news on the different stock market. But in case of spillover, we have to find out the positive as well as negative news on the stock market. So in my study, I have covered the spillover aspect. I will discover the impact of positive as well as negative news on different markets. And the significance of my area of study, that is the importance of the area of study of spot and future market, because in this area, we can find out the how introduction of future affect the volatility of the spot market, whether the volatility of the spot market increases or decreases. And part of importance of volatility spillover, because we all know that why spot market or future market dominate each other. It do not depend upon the index. Means we cannot identify the index for the future, but yes, we can identify the news, we can identify the different types of index. And the next part is price discovery. As we have studied earlier, that is the cost of carry model, the fair future price purely depend upon the spot price. But empirical results show differently. As they have shown, sometimes spot price leads the future price, sometimes future price leads the spot price. So in order to maintain the long-term equilibrium relationship, so we have to find out which price leads to other. These are the different research papers which I have reviewed. And the findings of these research paper is that sometimes there is a bidirectional spillover, sometimes there is a unidirectional spillover, and sometimes there is a no spillover from the spot market to future market. So in my study, what I will found here, what the research gap I will found here, that is volatility spillover between spot and future market is not examined on the decomposed component of the time series. Right. So I will apply the wavelet decomposition first in order to decompose the series. Then I will find out the volatility spillover with the help of E-Gartsch and DCC-Gartsch model. And wavelet decomposition on spot and future stock market is not available in literature. On the basis of these research gaps, what are my objective for my future study is to examine the volatility spillover effect between decomposed spot and future equity indices, and to study the price discovery relationship between the spot and future market in order to maintain the long-run equilibrium relationship and to find out the error correction mechanism between them. And last, the conclusion here is, it has been empirically proved the spot and future market market not only get influenced by its own event, it may get influenced by the events of the other market also. The interdependence of the market could be the reason for cross spillover, but some literature have showed that whether the markets are not integrated, even then they have a cross spillover during crisis period. A significant characteristics regarding volatility spillover that has been observed and well documented in literature is the property of asymmetry, that the negative news impact more as compared to the positive news. But I will study whether the positive news also affect for the decomposition of series or not. And last, it was found that the future market is showing the high level of volatility as compared to the spot market. All these results are based on the previous literature. But I will find out in my study whether these results are same for decomposed component or not. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Madam Shilpa, Madam, for your presentation. What are you currently doing? You're doing your PhD?
Yes, sir. I'm doing PhD under the supervision of Dr. Rupinder Katoch from LPU, from Lovely Professional University.
Your paper was a conceptual paper trying to develop the relationship. But the only problem is when you make it into a paper presentation for an international conference, I think there would have been some value if you have, once you have identified the research gap, if you could have moved into there must be some analysis, because you have just put your research work and the gap over there. So something else has to be added. Maybe it can be for one segment or one set of securities or one sector in the capital market. This is just a piece of what you have done so far. Beyond that, I think when you're making it for a presentation, try to put the analysis into a perspective so that it can get aligned with the research outcome. This is what I feel. Anything else to add, madam, and any other question?
Yeah, you're perfectly right, because she's already identified the research gap. She could have proceeded for some kind of analysis, maybe for a small duration relatively and with some model like that. That would have enhanced the paper.
Yes.
Can I ask a question, please, sir?
Yeah.
Yes.
You please, those who are raising questions, please introduce yourself and then raise the question.
Myself, Dr. Sada. I'm currently in Dubai. I just presented the paper before you. Shilpa, it's a brave attempt. It's a nice work. And only there is some confusion I have saw in your presentation is your objective is to find out the price discovery. And you are looking for the spot and future price relationship. So, and you are using a tool of Gartz. And what about the Granger causality?
For velocity spillover. Yes.
Okay. Spillover, and you decompose the data. That is perfectly fine. But my question is, how you find the causality? Are you using a Granger causality, or is the causation effect? It's a spot is lagging behind, or the future. So how the convergence happening in the price discovery process?
Yes, sir. I will find out with the help of Granger causality test, which market will lead to other, whether spot market or
exactly. So how the integration is happening, so you need to do the co-integration test. In your presentation, you mentioned about it.
It's only the part for my PhD thesis, but not complete. So I will use the Johansson co-integration test for non-stationary data for find out the long-term equilibrium relationship.
Thank you. Keep it up.
Go further.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Shilpa. All the very best in your academics and research from Lovely University. Thank you so much. Okay. So now I invite Alfie Maria Joseph, Jarin Joseph, and Anshu Srinivas Iyer from Christ Deemed to Be University. Their paper is titled "What is Slackening? The Growth of Student Managed Investment Funds in India." Over to you. You're there online? Anybody? The three among the three from Christ University, Bangalore.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir. So I will be sharing the screen now, and myself, Alfie Maria Joseph, and my partner Jarin Jose will be starting with the introduction.
Okay, start up.
I hope you can see my screen.
Yeah, the screen is coming up, yet to come.
Yeah, visible. Sir, is it there?
Yeah, now it is visible.
Okay, thank you, sir. Over to you, Jared. Jaren?
Yeah, Jaren, you're there online?
Hello, Jaren?
I think he's not online.
Sir, I guess he will unmute in a moment, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, he's having some technical glitches, sir. Sorry, sir.
Hello?
Yeah, you're audible. Yeah, you can start.
I'm sorry, sir. There was a small technical glitch.
Yeah, you can start now. We can hear you.
Okay, sir. So what is the investment funds in India? Yeah. This is the title of our research paper. And me, myself, Alfil, and Anusha ma'am, Dr. Anusha Srinivasan Iyer, we are undertaking this research under the guidance of ma'am. Alfil, over to the next slide. Okay. Next slide.
Yes, one second.
Yes, sure. So there are two forms of learning, academic learning and experiential learning. Academic learning is knowledge transmission through textbooks and classroom lectures, whereas in experiential learning, the knowledge is transmitted to modes like case studies and internships. Compared to academic learning, students get a realistic platform concepts in experiential learning, modes like internships, simulation, and everything. So what is SMIF? SMIF, or Student Managed Investment Fund, is an experiential learning technique that is considered the finest mode for teaching security analysis and portfolio management. So how does an SMIF operate? SMIF is an organization where students act as fund managers, analysts, investors, guided by a faculty mentor. They undertake EIC analysis, investor calls also are undertaken to their accountability. In short, students are immersed into the real world experience of fund management, where they manage a real rupee portfolio, which is indeed very effective and evident from the review of literature. They are able to get better student learning, better retention, and more recruitment attention, because their students are experienced before even being employed. Alfil, next slide.
Sure.
So these are basic concepts related to our research. So what is the rationale for our study? SMIFs are indeed the need of the hour, as two recent studies conducted in India pointed out that there are low levels of stock market awareness and literacy among the Indian youth. So one in the year 2018 and one in the year 2015. So how can SMIF alleviate this problem? Basically, as I previously explained, if students are engaged in an SMIF as investors, as fund managers, and as analysts, they will definitely gain knowledge and be able to get better able future fund managers in India. So except in the US and Canada, SMIFs in every country, including India, are in the early stages of development. So SMIFs, first SMIF in India was set up in the year 2001 in MTI Gurgaon. Even after two decades of its introduction, there are very few SMIFs, less than 10. So owing to the novelty in India, there is no article, even after our extensive ROL, review of literature, we were able to find no article examining the challenges faced by students in setting up an SMIF in India. Over to Alfil for explaining the objective of the study. Alfil?
Sorry.
Yeah, you can start. Continue, please.
Yes, I hope I'm audible.
Yeah, you're audible.
So this rationale mentioned by Jaren forms the main objective of our study. That is to understand the challenges faced by students in managing the student-managed investment fund in India. Moving on to the research methodology, We followed a qualitative research design with interpretivist paradigm, forming the basis of our study. The research method we followed is content analysis, wherein valid inferences are made from the interviews using interpretive approach. It is also used to identify the view of individuals with regard to a specific question. Our study uses an interview method to gather the data with the help of an interview guide containing 20 structured open-ended questions. This interview guide was verified by an academic expert from the qualitative research field. We conducted the interview via Zoom video conferencing platform. The study follows a purposive sampling technique with 10 student fund managers across India as the sample size, following the criterion of informational redundancy proposed by Lincoln and Guba. Moving on to the data analysis. We followed a qualitative content analysis method to extract our findings from the interview. The process of qualitative content analysis starts by transcribing the recorded interviews. These transcripts are then reread again and again to understand the deeper meaning inside every statement. Further, this transcript is divided into smaller text containing each sentences or known as meaning units. From the meaning units, that is this row statement, a core meaning is identified and the same is written as condensed meaning unit. So if I can quote an example, we asked an interviewee, is there faculties involved in managing the SMIF? And his answer, his statement was written in this PPT. So the problem is that it is not a business school. Since we are liberal arts school, it is very academic oriented, not very practical or business oriented. That is why we have other people helping us and not the faculties. So from this, we extracted the core meaning. And the core meaning is converted into condensed meaning unit. Since the college is very academic oriented, we don't approach faculties for help. Further, the next step is to label this condensed meaning units by formulating them into quotes. The quotes in this case will be, faculties in non-business schools lacks practical orientation. So all those quotes which are formed, which belong to the same category, and then they are grouped together under the head categories. In this example, the category will be challenges due to curriculum and pedagogy in arts colleges. In the last stage, all those categories which are similar and comes under the same group are considered as one broad theme. And the theme name for this particular category will be SMIF in arts colleges, a big challenge. So this is the entire process of qualitative content analysis with an example. Thus, once the analysis is completed, we identified four main broad themes as the findings, each containing 2 to 3 categories. So the main themes are, the first one is dilemma of registration, SMIF manager opinions, as you can see in the slide. Under this, the categories include challenges due to registration as well as non-registration. The second theme includes registration process and its aftermath, which includes all those challenges which is happening during the registration process with special reference to government colleges and post-registration. The third theme is, as I explained in the previous slide, SMIF in arts colleges, a big challenge. Under this, all those challenges which is related to curriculum, pedagogy, infrastructure comes under this theme. And the last one is ideal structure and functioning, still an unfulfilled aspiration. Structure, liquidation, yearly liquidation challenges, and the ineffective admission process come under this theme. So these themes will be briefly explained in the later sessions. Moving on to the first theme. The first theme is dilemma of registration, SMIF manager opinions. The very first question that needs to be addressed by students before the actual functioning of SMIF is whether to get the fund registered or not. Few managers felt that the registration would bring in more complexities, which include mandatory audit and preparation of annual reports. They were also of the opinion that the tenure of managers is very short, so managers keep on changing, and this would create unnecessary legalities. In case of registering as a partnership firm, since the partners keep on changing as the students graduate, it will lead to the closure of the existing partnership firm and creation of a new partnership, which again brings in the change in partnership deed and all those things. So this would be a burdensome on every managers who joined the funds, that is every students who join. Having these many challenges said, some other managers were also of the opinion that non-registering the fund would also bring in issues, such as the capital or the corpus contributed to this fund would be transferred to any member's individual bank account, because they, since they are not registered, they cannot have a common account. So these are some of the other challenges due to because of non-registration. So this slide would help the audience in understanding how these codes are formulated into categories and themes. This is also an example of how the second theme is formulated. SMI Fine Arts College is a big challenge. From these codes, categories are formed, and from two categories, a broad theme is formed. So the audience will get a clear understanding about how the qualitative content analysis actually works. Now, moving over to Jaren for explaining the other three themes.
Thank you, Alfil. The next slide. So as Alfil clearly mentioned, there is a mixed opinion about registering the fund, as she previously explained. Then other key aspects we were able to draw from the interview was, it is difficult to legally recognize an SMIF in colleges because government colleges are reluctant to allow students to register the SMIF because the possibility of losses due to unexpected risk is high. That is the reason. And also due to certain technical aspects during registration, students are facing challenges, student fund managers. So owing to the lack of awareness of students, students may make mistake in minute technical aspects while applying for DMAT account. So that is a big challenge they are facing. Alumni is under pressure from employers. So one of the respondent who had apparently registered a fund as a partnership, when she had passed out and she was an alumni, when she joined for a job, she was put in a clause. Either you resign from that partnership from being a partner or you resign from our job. So it is difficult as a challenge to register the fund because alumni face a challenge in employment after registering the fund. So that is one challenge the student fund managers are facing. Next, SMIF in liberal arts college, a difficult venture. As Alfil had shown how it was coded and categorized, and finally the theme was drawn. There was only one SMIF we were able to interview in an arts college. So they faced in lack of infrastructure facilities. They didn't have any database to conduct equity research, and they did not have faculty support also because the faculties were academic oriented. So that was the challenge faced by liberal arts college. SMIF structural issues, because since it's new in India, there are very problems like transition of power to juniors, yearly liquidation because MBA programs and UG programs are 3 years or 2 years, and they can only run the fund for only 1 year, due to which they won't be able to get more returns. They won't be able to apply long-term investment strategies. They won't be, they will be more accountable too. So that is another challenge we were able to retrieve from the interview. And even after they are taking rigorous process to select candidates, the candidates turn out to be ineffective. So that was another challenge. Next slide, Alfil, conclusion. So from our whole study, we were able to draw these conclusions. After 20 years from the first inception of SMIF in India, there are still challenges being faced by student fund managers. To registering the fund, aftermath of registration, the legal compliances with relation to registration, the structural issues still pertaining to the novelty, the functioning, and academic curriculum with respect to our colleges are still lacking behind in setting up an SMIF. And currently, as I said, registration aspect, in the registration front, they are facing a lot of problems. So until a viable solution is found or a suitable solution is found, the viable registration form for an SMIF is partnership firm or a society under Societies Registration Act 1860. And for a SMIF in government college, it is to have an unregistered SMIF, which has a partnership deed, so as to cover the legal aspect or give an entity to the SMIF. And one-time investment will solve the problem of short-term tenure of SMIF. It will make the SMIF perennial. So if the fund managers are able to give a one-time investment, they can keep the fund invested lifelong. And this will help their juniors to make the fund perennial also and have a lot of learnings with respect to long-term investment. And a prolonged admission process, in addition to other criteria, can eliminate the issue of a less dedicated member coming into the SMIF. So these were the broad conclusions and suggestions we were able to draw from our study, sir and ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you,
sir.
Thank you, Jaren Jose, for your presentation. Your theme is Student Management Investment Fund. I would like to know whether you have actually selected only liberal arts college, or does it include specifically business schools? How did you actually go for it?
Asil, you go for it?
Yeah, sure. No, so not only liberal arts colleges, only one liberal arts college. Then there were government colleges, IIM, Calcutta, all those IIMs were there. Then also other business schools were also there. So it was a mix of liberal arts colleges, government colleges, private colleges, everything was there.
In that case, what would be the qualitative measuring tool that you have used, the scaling technique or whatever that you have used, based on the variables that you have identified? Because they are responding on a qualitative mode. So what could be the scaling that you have done?
So are you asking about the sampling technique, sir? Like, how do you select the sample?
The sampling technique. Suppose you are asking for the challenges or the reasons. How do you actually measure? Because these are not quantifiable values, like saying 10 or 20. So obviously there would be some kind of a response where they would say that they have some problems, they have some difficulties. How do you actually scale them? Because you said you're using a qualitative technique over there.
Sir, I believe with the use of qualitative content analysis, we can extract all these informations. May I add, sir?
Yeah, so, sure. sir, our paradigm is positivist. So when our guide was speaking with us, she said it is not pure quantitative approach. It's a pure qualitative approach. So we identify the factors, and that is the objective of our study, sir.
Do you have
the theory?
Management investment fund at Christ University?
No, sir. We are planning to.
No, sir. We are planning for that. I mean, this research article will be an insight for the students, sir.
Okay. Yeah, madam. We believe, sir. Hemal madam, anything you would like to add?
Yeah, you could have extended your study by using some structured questionnaire, and you could have used some statements to identify the exact challenges and difficulties faced by the students. Okay, and you could have asked the ratings on 5-point Likert scale or maybe 7-point Likert scale. Okay, that is how you could have measured. You would have converted into some quantitative form, which can be analyzed further using some techniques. Of course, this part is okay. This part is, of course, very nice. Qualitative aspect is you have highlighted very nicely. But this could have been extended to numerical aspect also.
I think in a similar study, just as an input for you, when one of the challenges with the student management investment funds are facing, you said SMIF is 10 in number. But the problem is if you look at states like Maharashtra or Gujarat, you will see in Pune, Mumbai, most of the business schools, they have got investment clubs and all. So exactly as you said, the problem that they face is, I'm a student for 3 years or 5 years. So SEBI is talking about how to ensure some kind of a continuity in membership even after you leave your academic institution. Because otherwise nobody will be interested. I'm just starting off and I leave my money back. So that kind of an initiative is being talked about in some of the student investment forums which are coming up across the country. So I think it would be good if you could examine some of those things from your side, from Christ University. Anybody else from the participants who would like to raise a question, a couple of questions? There's no questions? So in that case, we'll move on to the third paper, Effect of Commodities. So thank you, Alfil and Jaren, and we'll move on
thank
to the
next paper.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Effect of Commodity Futures Traded on MCX in India. The presenter is Sandeep Sharawat of Jamia Millia University, New Delhi. Along with his guide, they have a joint work. So, Sandeep, if you are there, you can...
Good morning to both the chairpersons. I am Sandeep.
Morning.
Am I audible to both of you?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yes.
Without wasting your time, I am just starting sharing the screen.
Sure. Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, sir. So as you can see that I am doing a PhD right now from the Department of Commerce and Business Studies from Jamia Millia Islamia University, and I am doing the part of my PhD thesis actually it is, and I am working on commodity sector for related to futures and spot price, and under my guide Dr. Ravinder Kumar. So introduction part is like the what we have. What sir, you got from the first article? It is almost same. So I'm not wasting the time on it. And other going on the next slide, which is related to the statement of my problem, sir. As you know that working has been done on the share market related to futures and spot price, but commodity sectors is not being touched till now. It is even in the beginning stage, the introductory stage, and many of the people are not even investing particularly in it. So I am considering the commodity sector where I am taking the effect of futures contract, which is to be traded in the MCX in India. And although there are 5 commodities which are traded in MCX, multi-commodity exchanges, but I have taken only 3 commodities based on their data and actively traded, like cardamom, cotton, and mentha oil. My objective here is to find out the relationship between the spot and future prices in these 3 agriculture commodities which are traded in MCX. I have taken 3 commodities in my methodology: cardamom, cotton, and mentha oil. The time I have taken for the data is from September 2009 to August 2019. Although the time can be different for different commodities because of the availability of the data. And if at some point of time futures price is not available for a particular date, then I have taken off that date and the spot price is also eliminated from it. And the spot price I have taken from CMIE, which is Center for Monitoring Indian Economy. And the futures price I have taken from the Capital Line CSS related to MCX. And I have firstly doing the stationarity test for which I have taken the Augmatic Dickey Fuller test. And then I have considered Johansson's approach to test the co-integration between the futures and spot price in these 3 commodities. So here is the first commodity, both sir and ma'am, that is cardamom, where sir, you can see it yourself that on the left hand side, the augmented Dickey Fuller test is saying that there is a unit root test, but it is not accepted because the probability value is very high from the significance level, which is 5%, and even the t statistic, which is the 0.25, which is within the range of it. So it says that there is a non-stationarity in the cardamom. And it is in the same way in the log spot price, it can be seen that 77 is the probability value, which is higher than the level of significance. So there is also non-stationarity in the log spot price. And because of the paucity of the word limit in the articles, like 2500 words, I am not able to show the ADF for the written series. Although ADF on the written series is saying that after the first differencing of both the futures price and spot price, it becomes stationary. So if the series is become stationary after the first differencing, then there may exist some co-integration between them. So that co-integration is I have find out through the help of Johansson co-integration test, where you can see that sir, both the trace and maximum Egan value is saying that at most one co-integration error is present because the probability value is 0.71 greater than the level of significance, and none co-integration error is rejected. So there is at least one co-integration between both of them. Now I am going on the next commodity, which is cotton, which is again showing the same result that the log spot, the futures price and spot price are non-stationary. And Johansson co-integration test is saying that there is at most one co-integration based on trace and maximum Egan value. Probability value is higher, critical value, trace statistic is within the range of critical value. Then I'm going from the third commodity, which is mentha oil, which is again showing the same result, like the futures price, law futures price is non-stationary and the return price becomes stationary after first differencing. And then the co-integration, I have seen that at most one is there through the trace and maximum Egan value. So my conclusion is that there is a kind of relationship between these two, between all the these 3 commodities in terms of their futures and spot prices as they are traded on MCX. So further evaluation can be done that what kind of relationship is that, long term, short run, how, what kind of Granger causality is going on there, which one is following which one. And in that way, sir, I am doing my that bit related to that particular paper, which is the part of my PhD thesis. Thank you, sir, without wasting too much of time. Any valuable comments from your side, as I am like the ABC Darian in the field of research right now.
Okay, thank you. Very good. And good presentation. Again, I would like to remind you, just like we had in the earlier presentation by Dilpa Madam, when you take your research work, fine, you can take your research work, you can select it and use it for an international seminar paper. But it should not essentially be confined to what has been done there at the level at which it has been done there. It's the same thing you were repeating. Like you have studied this, you are in the process of studying this. So maybe one of the commodities, maybe cotton or maybe for oil, one of the commodities, you could have extended it specifically for this, because there is obviously a question coming up, what exactly was the additional part which you would like to project in this particular paper beyond your research. So try to make it in that form, because yes, for your paper, your title, your spot future relationship, you're proceeding on that line, that is fine, absolutely fine, there's no problem. But there must be something additional which you say is the work that I've done for this particular research paper. It can be even a segment or a part. So that is, apart from that, I found it to be all very fine. Another remark that I would like to make, not for this paper, generally for all, because when we use your SPSS or statistical packages or software packages for analysis of data, obviously it will give a result. Now, our problem is to give more life to that result, because here you are again talking about stationarity, and that same non-stationarity that existed is existing for all the three commodities. That is what the software or the package gives as output. Now, it is for you to say, is there any reason behind this? Is there any reason for this to be similar? Is it because there is no adequate speculation, or is it because it stands out only at the level of investment? So that kind of an analysis, are you attempting any of those things, or do you have some plans to have some of those things in your mind? Because that will be useful for your future perspectives of good research on this. So if you have something, you can add on to that. Otherwise, your presentation is very fine.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I will take care of your valuable points in my research work.
Thank you. Madam, you have got something to add?
Yeah, you could have added some more analysis by using the co-integration equation. Okay, here you're simply highlighting that there is a long-term relationship. Okay, but then how to use that relationship for future prediction or for building up an appropriate model? Fine, that kind of extension should have been done for each of the three selected commodities.
Okay, ma'am.
Can I say something, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Good morning, all of you. Can I say something?
Sure. You can. Sure.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm Dr. Srinivas from Department of Economics, Jamia Millia Islamia.
Yeah.
I would like to give suggestions to this Sandeep.
Yeah.
In fact, when he was quoting CMIE data with regard to the three commodities, MCX and all, we can why stationarity is there. You can bring the data into the picture. See, thing is that as researchers, we all have been adopting some techniques and we are getting the results. Unfortunately, now we are not able to capturing why the results has been arriving and, you know, how, what are the, all these things are available in the CMIE data, and he can capture with the separate product type and he can develop the paper. That's what I would like to tell you, Sandeep. You can develop this paper. It's very good thing, and Dickey-Polar test and all, you have done excellent thing. But thing is that we as a researcher, we need to find, see, in economics research also, people do tell that there is an increase and there is a decrease. But why there is an increase, why there is a decrease, you need to tell as a researcher. That's the point I would like to tell. Thank you, sir. Professor Simon also been in those lines, but I wanted to give you with regard to CMIE data, it is available in that.
That's what I was
saying. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank
because
you.
More important is what are you trying to, because results will definitely come. Now, what are these results speaking beyond the basic
numbers? Yes.
Even if you say there is a correlation or there is an association, why it is happening, that is more important. Anyway, you have done a good work, and I think this, what Professor Srinivas has given here and others have shared, will be valuable inputs for you and for all researchers in future. Thank you so much. We go on to the next paper. The next paper is titled.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I'm sorry for interrupting. We had missed one paper in between. It's by comparative analysis of the determinants of financial inclusion and digital financial inclusion in India by Srinivas Bhatla and Ankita Gupta. Can I call them, sir?
Yeah,
on your behalf?
Okay,
yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, so
participants, a gentle reminder before you start the presentation, please keep it short as possible so that we can give a chance to all of them who wanted to present their papers. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I hope my screen is visible and I'm audible.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am, your screen is visible.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm Ankita Gupta. I'm a research scholar under the supervision of Dr. Bhatla Srinivasa, sir, who is an associate professor in Jamia Millia Islamia, Department of Economics. So I'm going to present this paper titled Comparative Analysis of the Determinants of Financial Inclusion and Digital Financial Inclusion in India. Introduction. Financial inclusion, it has been defined as the process of ensuring access to financial services and the timely and adequate credit where needed by the vulnerable groups such as weaker sections and the low income groups at an affordable cost in the Rangarajan Committee Report 2008. So the focus of this definition has been on the access to financial services. However, over the time, the policymakers, they are focusing on the other dimensions of financial inclusion as well. For example, in India's National Strategy for Financial Inclusion 2019-24, they have quantified financial inclusion across three indexes, which is access, usage, and quality. And in the similar terms, digital financial inclusion has been defined as digital access to and the use of formal financial services by the excluded and the underserved populations by CGAP, which is a World Bank group. So in order, if we have to understand financial inclusion and the digital financial inclusion, it is important to focus on both the dimensions, that is access and usage, which my study is going to do. And the importance of financial inclusion and the digital financial inclusion, it has been widely recognized as they are the important enablers for many of the sustainable development goals. The statement of the problem. So as per the World Bank report of 2017, India has overcome two out of the four challenges faced by the emerging economies on their way to digital transformation. The two challenges which have been overcome are underdeveloped technology ecosystem and the weak infrastructure. However, the other two challenges which still remain to be overcome are low penetration of the formal financial services and the low income and financial literacy levels. Also, the schemes like Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana, they have increased the access to bank accounts. However, it has still not transformed into their frequent use. And further, the use of digital financial services, it is still very low in comparison to the use of formal financial services amongst certain sections of the society. So all of these statements of problems, this has led us to this paper. In this paper, I am trying to compare the determinants of financial inclusion and digital financial inclusion. And I'm specifically focusing on the two dimensions, which is access and use. So whatever the level of literature I have done, to the best of my knowledge, there are very few papers which have identified the determinants of digital financial inclusion in India, while specifically focusing on the dimensions, which is access and use. So not only our paper is adding to the literature, but also it can be very helpful in the policy formulation as well. So on the basis of this, the objectives of our study are as follows. The first objective is to analyze and compare the determinants of access to financial services and the access to digital financial services. And my second objective is to analyze and compare the determinants of use of financial services and the use of digital financial services. The methodology. So our paper is based on the secondary data from the World Bank's Global Findex Micro Level 2017 data. the analysis is particularly for India, and we have performed binary probit regression analysis to identify the determinants of financial inclusion and digital financial inclusion. The dependent variable for access to financial services is formal account, while the dependent variable for access to digital financial services is owning a mobile phone, access to debit card, and access to credit card. Then the use. The dependent variable for the use of financial services are the formal savings and the formal credit, while the dependent variable for the use of digital financial services is the use of debit card in the past 12 months, use of credit card in the past 12 months, and the bills paid over the internet. The explanatory variables used in the model are age, gender, workforce participation, income, and education. We have taken two measures of age. First is exact age, and the other one is age squared. The second measure, that is age squared, it has been taken to incorporate the nonlinear relationship of age with the financial inclusion and the digital financial inclusion. And all of these above mentioned variables, these are the dummy variables. Then we come to the analysis part. This is the first objective, which is access to financial services and the digital financial services. And this table represents the probit estimates for the determinants of access to financial services and the access to digital financial services. So it can be observed that the access to financial services, which is formal account, it is significantly and positively associated with age, workforce participation, and education. Now, although the probability of having access to formal account, it is increasing with age, it starts decreasing after a certain age has been attained, and it is visible through the negative coefficient of the age squared. Then we move to the access to digital financial services. So it can be seen that owning a mobile phone and a debit card, it is positively associated with age, workforce participation, education, high income, and negatively associated with an individual being a woman. However, if you look at the credit card, there are very few significantly positive determinants, which are workforce participation, income, and education. So the comparative analysis, it is revealing that being a poor and a woman, it reduces the access to access to digital financial services. However, it has no impact on access to financial services. Then we move to our second objective. And this is the table which represents the probit estimates for the determinants of use of financial services and the use of digital financial services. And it can be seen that the use of financial services in terms of formal savings, it is positively associated with age, workforce participation, high income, and education. However, the only positive determinant of formal credit is workforce participation. Then the use of all the digital financial services is positively associated with the income and education. However, what are the interesting results are such that being a woman, it is reducing the use of debit card. However, it is increasing the probability of bills paid over the internet. And also, age is positively associated with the use of debit card and bills paid over the internet. And similarly, workforce participation, it is increasing the use of debit card and the credit card. Then we have the comparative analysis. Comparative analysis are revealing that gender, it is associated with the use of digital financial services. However, it has no significant impact on the use of financial services. However, all other determinants, they are common to both the use of financial services and the digital financial services. So then we move to our conclusions and suggestions. So it can be seen that the determinants of financial inclusion and the digital financial inclusion, they are differing to a certain extent. One of the main results is that being a woman, it is significantly associated with the digital financial inclusion, but not financial inclusion. So the reason behind this is that the government has come up with various schemes with regard to the financial inclusion. And one of the main prominent is PMJDY. So my suggestion for this is that there should be digital financial literacy and the awareness programs specifically targeting women, and they can have a more impact if the trainees themselves are women, because there have been a case study where the business women business correspondents, they increase the engagement of low income women with the financial services. So the same scheme that can be adopted for the digital financial inclusion as well to deal with the digital financial exclusion. Then we have the second conclusion, which is that an individual being poor, it reduces the probability of access and the use of digital financial services, while it decreases the probability of only formal savings with respect to financial inclusion. Therefore, high income or low, being a poor, it is affecting only the use of financial services, not the access. So same is the concept that little work has been done on the digital financial inclusion, it needs to be emphasized that people get the stable employment, so that we know that 95% of our economy is in the informal sector. So if people get the formal employment and they have a stable income, so they can go more for the digital financial inclusion as well. So we can see that there are differences in the determinants of financial inclusion and digital financial inclusion, and which can be helpful for the policy formulation while specifically targeting at the access and the use. So that's all from my side. These are the references.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. What were exactly the financial services that you have covered? Well, two questions from my side. One is, what were the financial services you covered? And when you looked at age, when you looked at gender, when you looked at income and all,
yes,
were these factors same for the digital as well as non-digital, or where did you find the difference, and why was that specifically coming up only for the digital financial services?
So the financial services that I have focused upon are the savings and credit. The other financial services I could not focus upon because of the constraints of the secondary data and the variables.
Only banking service.
Yes, sir. Yes. Credit and savings.
What could be the reason why the digital mode has got a different format? Is it because of poverty?
Sir, I did not got your question. I'm so sorry.
Was this factor that you're saying that for women and for those who are poor, the digital, you found a difference, right?
Yes, sir.
So can we conclude that poverty is leading to less access to digital financial services?
Yes, sir. I agree that first reason is that government has been working on financial inclusion for quite a long time, and digital financial inclusion has come into forefront recently. So while the government, while the women are moving into the form of financial inclusion, it is going to take a longer time to move to the digital financial inclusion. And the reasons are many. First of all, the employment reason. When they get employed, they want to use more and more of the services. Okay. These are the basic services in the financial inclusion which women are using as of now. But if they will move to digital financial inclusion, they will be using more of services which is still limited. So it is the employment as well as the income.
You're from Jamia Millia, no? So which part of the country your sample was from?
So this is a whole India.
Whole India.
This is the secondary data.
Thank you. So based on secondary data, which was the source?
So World Bank's Global Findex data 2017. Oh. Yes.
Fine. Okay. Anything else, madam, you would like to ask?
Sir, can I ask the questions myself? Dr. Devi Prasad Satpathy from Odisha.
Okay, sure. You can.
Yes.
Yeah. Ma'am, there is a question. You have tested the goodness of the fit of this model?
Sorry, no, I have not.
Have you tested the goodness?
Actually, they were log likelihood values.
Then how can we validate the model?
I'm telling you, they were the log likelihood values which I have not included in this table. Like for each of these variables, there was log likelihood values, and which showed that this model is significant. Okay. If you want to show those values as well.
No, that's okay. Log likelihood. That's okay.
It is done. It seems. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, madam, Samuel, madam, anything else you would like to
add? Yeah, log likelihood values, they appear as the part of the output itself, isn't it? So then you can automatically get the model validated.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that's one thing. Another thing is that if you want to know the real picture, fine. Primary study would rather reveal the clear picture.
Should I say something, ma'am? I'm pursuing a PhD on digital financial inclusion. And my whole PhD thesis, this is based on the primary data only. So I will continue with that as well.
Okay, fine.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Okay, thank you so much. I wish you all the very best. We'll go to the next paper. The next paper is on performance of managed funds. Am I right? A conceptual study based on efficient market hypothesis. The paper is being presented by Mini Mary Naiman. Over to you. You are there online? Okay.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can start.
Question. 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 pursuing a PhD on digital financial inclusion, and one will be focusing on primary data model.
So, is it visible?
Yeah, it's coming.
Yes. Mini ma'am, yes, it's visible. You can carry on.
Thank you. A good day to the dignitaries on the chair. I am Mini Mary Nainan from Department of Commerce, CMS College, Kottayam. The title of the presentation, my article, is Manage Funds and Market Efficiency. It is authored with Dr. Tommy Matthew, Department of Commerce, CMS College, Kottayam. The content of my presentation is divided into four sections, which include introduction of the study, reviews, discussion regarding the core theme, that is manage funds and market efficiency, and conclusion. Introduction. Equity market has always been an attractive option to the investors due to the high rate of returns, but the lack of expertise has been a problem always. The introduction of managed funds tried to bridge this problem by offering varieties of portfolios to the investors. Equity portfolios are managed either actively or passively. In actively managed funds, there is active involvement by the fund managers in choosing the composition of the portfolio and also in the frequent revision and evaluation. While passively managed funds try to replicate a benchmark index in their portfolio, and hence the involvement of a fund manager is reduced to its minimum. Mutual funds are the actively managed funds, while index funds and exchange-traded funds are examples of passively managed funds. Active management is intended to outperform the market, while passive management is always on a run to perform as the market performs. The theory of efficient market hypothesis proposed by Eugene Fama states that markets are of three forms, namely weak, semi-strong, strong form, all based on their informational efficiency. Fama study efficiency has proved that an informationally efficient market cannot be outperformed. This study intends to examine the literature for the performance of actively managed funds and passively managed funds in the light of the market efficiency. Reviews regarding the performance of managed funds. Literature regarding the performance of managed funds given inconclusive evidence. However, the performance of actively managed funds seems to be at par or underperform the market. Fama and French found that the aggregate return of the US mutual funds is close to the returns of the market portfolio, but the cost of management reduced their returns. However, a reappraisal of the same study was conducted in 2019, which found that even when the expense ratios had reduced, the performance of US equity mutual funds still remained to be poor and had not contributed to better alphas. Reviews pertaining to the efficiency of stock markets. Grossman and Stiglitz states that a market cannot be perfectly informationally efficient, because if that was the case, there wouldn't have been any return for gathering information. Pandey 2003, Khan 2013 concluded their study by stating the Indian market to be weakly efficient, and then there are studies which prove the market to be semi-strong level of efficient, and there are studies which have proved the market to be totally inefficient too. Studies give an inconclusive evidence with respect to efficiency of Indian stock market. Studies have also found that there is significant presence of anomalies. Recent studies have also laid emphasis on the behavioral patterns in Indian stock market. All these would prove the inefficiency of Indian stock market in its weak form itself. Discussion on the core topic, which is managed funds and market efficiency. The active management undertaken by active fund managers assume the market to be inefficient and aim to outperform the market. These managers try to outperform the market through the mispricing cost in the market, either by a piece of information or by the behavioral patterns of the individual investors. A persistent outperformance by the actively fund managers is out of scope, as the mispricing gets corrected soon. The efficiency of the market hence plays an important role. The level of efficiency is the underlying fact that creates scope for the fund managers to act accordingly. One of the recent developments in finance is the behavioral finance, which claims that behavioral patterns of individual investors in response to the information explosion do cause mispricing. That would affect the efficiency of stock market, leaving further scope for managers of the active fund to earn abnormal returns. the two ideologies that emerge here are, if the number of irrational... If irrational investors are... If the number of irrational investors is high in the stock market, the irrationality would become the trend and the institutional investors or rational investors would fear going against the trend, leaving lesser scope for abnormal returns. If the irrational investors are less in number, the irrationality would be swiftly corrected by the rational investors, or in fact, the well-informed and efficient institutional investors, by reaping the scope for returns created by the behavioral patterns. Be it the efficient market hypothesis or the behavioral finance that dominate the market, both are based on the information which would create either an efficiency or an inefficiency in the stock market. Here, the active managers manage the fund to take advantage of the situation and to outperform the market, which is represented by the benchmark index. The passive management is based on the fact that markets are informationally efficient and hence there is no scope for the abnormal returns. According to Grossman and Stiglitz, the actively managed funds are the drivers of market efficiency. Any mispricing or the anomalies found through extensive research and analysis is corrected by these fund managers. Farmer had put forward that the markets cannot be perfectly informationally efficient, that provides a scope for arbitrage or abnormal returns. Hence, if the managers of the actively managed funds are not able to perform well for the price charged by them, this indicates the inefficiency of the fund managers. Moving to the conclusion, if the markets are inefficient or efficient in the weak or semi-strong form of efficiency, actively managed funds should outperform the passively managed funds. But if the actively managed funds are not able to outperform, the reason could be either with regard to informational efficiency of the market or the operational inefficiency of the fund managers. Most of the studies found the Indian stock market to be inefficient in the strong form. However, the active fund managers were not able to outperform the market. Hence, it would indicate that the active fund managers were not able to outperform the market due to their operational inefficiency. These are the references. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, madam. Again, you have nicely brought out the literature regarding efficient market theories. But again, we could not actually get which are the actively managed funds that you have subjected to analysis, if at all there was an analysis, which are the passively managed funds that were subjected to analysis, and what are the inferences, because at the end you are talking about the conclusion. Is the conclusion purely, is it just merely based on the theoretical backup that you have, or have you made some picked up certain specific funds and done your own analysis for the same?
Sir, actually, this is part of my research. And I have conducted the study. I have conducted the empirical study separately for inefficiency of the market, to test the inefficiency of the market, and also for the performance of mutual funds and exchange-traded funds. In the PP, they've already mentioned that actively managed funds are mutual funds and passively managed funds are exchange-traded funds. So I've compared the performance of these two types of funds and was found that mutual funds does not outperform. But for this particular study, it was not actually recorded because the study that had conducted was only for 5 years. So that's the reason why I didn't include the analysis part in this study.
Okay, fine. So that limitation stands out, because when we look at what is actually the outcome, it has to be specific to a context or to a specific fund or to a specific sector, or based on some, what do you call, concrete evidence which you have actually gathered for your purpose. Okay, so thank you so much, madam. You can add on.
Yeah, your study would have been more enhanced if you would have supported it by some empirical evidence, isn't it? Even though maybe for a small period and for the small selected funds only, but at least you should have supported with some empirical evidence to prove the theories on the basis of literature. That's not a kind of, you know, original research.
Okay.
You can do that in the course of your work. Anything else? Yeah. Anybody wants to add one question from the participant? Okay, in that case, shall we go to the next paper? the next paper. Thank you, madam, so much for your presentation. And we go to the next paper, the impact of COVID-19 on dynamic linkages between oil prices and stock markets in BRICS. The paper is by Neha Gupta from Amity University, Noida, along with her guide. So over to you, Neha Gupta. You are not yet audible.
Ma'am, your voice is low.
Ma'am, is it okay now?
No.
Ma'am,
no.
Still your voice is feeble.
Is it okay now, ma'am?
You have a problem.
Sir, let me disconnect my Bluetooth. Wait, give me a second. Just.
Yeah.
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah. A very good morning. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to present my paper here.
Ma'am, there is a small disturbance in your sound. Otherwise, everything else is fine. Now it's okay, ma'am. You can carry on.
Yeah,
ma'am, is my slide? Are my slides are visible?
Your slide is visible,
ma'am. You can carry on.
Okay. Good morning to all, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to present my paper here. As you can see on the screen, my topic is impact of COVID-19 on the dynamic linkage between oil price and stock market in BRICS. First of all, I want to give a very brief overview on these terms, which are part of my research paper. COVID-19. With the epic center in Wuhan, China, the pandemic of COVID-19 has turned the global financial market, economic activity, employment, and gross domestic product of the countries. As a result of lockdown, a sharp reduction in oil consumption resulted in an extreme decline in crude oil prices in the international market from USD 61 on January 2, 2020, to USD 12 on April 20, 2020. The COVID-19 has also produced a shocking impact on the stock market globally. The stock market of developing countries, US fell by 32%, UK by 27.9%, Italy by 39.3%. Even the stock markets of emerging countries have also not been hit by the pandemic. Brazil stock is declined by 40.5%, Russia by 24.2%, and China by 10.1%. This discussion clearly stated that COVID-19 has a significant impact on oil price movement and stock market. Now, talking about the relationship of oil price and stock market,
No problem, you can continue.
Empirical research has been done and found that there exists a significant relationship between oil price and stock market. The underlying assumption is based on the fact that oil is the best fundamental input in the most form production. Therefore, any change in oil price leads to change in cost, earnings, dividend, and stock market. BRICS, as emerging economies, are continuously growing. The impact of oil price shock on BRICS stock market would be different because of their different oil dependency status in global oil market. There are some which has already proved that at the time of financial crisis, the magnitude and direction of relationship between oil price and stock market changes. Now, COVID-19 impact of oil price movement and stock market indices, it is necessary to carry out further research on financial implication of COVID-19. Keeping all this in mind, this paper is investigate how the outbreak of COVID-19 pandemic affect the dynamic linkage between oil price movement and stock market of the BRIC countries. This paper makes an effort to understand the selective stock indices behavior during the pre-COVID period and post-COVID period. To conduct my research, data is collected from Energy Information Administration and official website of Yahoo Finance. Data period span from January 5 to 30 November 2020. To conduct the whole examination, the period is divided in two sub periods, that is pre-COVID period and post-COVID period. And EBS 9 software is used for descriptive analysis, time plot, vector autoregression, and various decomposition analysis. Talking about the data analysis interpretation part, the multivariate causality among the selected time series, namely oil price and stock indices, is examined using VOR method. The VOR method assumes that each of the included series is endogenous in the system of equation, and the causality relationship is examined from the remaining endogenous variable in the VOR system. In the VOR system, the lag values, lag order is chosen carefully with the help of VOR order selection criteria. The result shows that the stock market of Brazil, China, and South Africa is influenced by oil price movement in post-COVID and pre-COVID period. And the stock market is majorly influenced by stock market only in both pre-COVID and post-COVID period. And oil price is highly influenced by South Africa oil price movement in pre-COVID period only. The result of various decomposition analysis shows that stock market of South Africa, Russia, and Brazil are explained by lag value of oil price in post-COVID period only. These are some conclusions. COVID-19 has significantly influenced the dynamic relationship between oil price movement and stock market of BRICS nation. Before the procurement of COVID-19, the oil price movements are influenced by variation in stock market indices, whereas after the procurement of COVID-19, stock market movements are influenced by variation in oil price movements. These are some references. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, madam. What prompted you actually to link between oil prices and stock market indices? Because was there any prior literature which talks about this linkage? And in the BRICS nation, what was the broad index that you have actually included?
Sir, can you repeat your question? I'm not properly able to.
What prompted you actually to link between oil prices and stock market indices, number one, and which are the broad indices that you have selected for BRICS?
Sir, oil is the most commodity, most traded energy commodity.
Okay, then?
Theoretically, the existence of relationship between oil price and stock market is through various channels. First of all, oil is the basic input of the production. And change in oil price influence the behavior of the consumer. Foreign direct investment on oil price relation. There is a strong relationship between oil price and stock market.
Okay, fine. What about the BRICS indices, the nations for under BRICS?
Sir, are you asking me why I have chosen BRICS?
No. What are the indices that you say? For example, you take in India, you took BSE or NSE or like that. What do you do in the for Brazil, Russia, China? Which were the indices you took? Which were the broad indices that you have included for stock market?
So through the previous research paper, I have chosen the. Gone through some previous research paper.
Okay, fine.
Stock indices of BRICS.
You can add, madam.
Yeah, as regards the duration of your study, pre-COVID period is of, I think, 5 years, roughly, yes, isn't it? And post-COVID period is only hardly 1 year. Okay, so yes. Do you think that you can run the model consistently over this and conclude pre and post just on the basis of ununiform period?
Ma'am, this is the only data to conduct this studies.
Okay, fine. But actually, you know, we could have taken rather than the longer duration pre-period, we could have taken 2 years before and 2 years after, or 1 year before and 1 year after. And you could have taken the daily prices and like that, you know, daily data.
Okay, ma'am.
Got it.
Ma'am, I have already taken daily prices.
Huh, but then the duration of 5 years prior to the event, okay, and only 1 year prior after the event, that doesn't make consistent result.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, any other question? Okay, shall we move to the next paper?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Neha Gupta, for your presentation. The next paper is on range of cost of capital of Indian companies. A four-factor model application. The presenter is Nivya Unni from Cochin University of Science and Technology, along with Dr. Santosh Kumar. So over to you.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yes, ma'am, you're audible now.
Yeah, you can share.
Is it visible now?
Yeah, it's coming.
Ma'am, it just shows it's starting to share the content. It's not yet visible. Your slide is not yet visible.
Showing starting to share.
Is it visible?
Not yet.
No. Okay. Not yet, ma'am. A message is displayed as Ms. Nivya Unni is starting to share the content. Your slideshow is not yet visible.
Okay, okay. Okay, just 1 minute.
No, not yet.
Not yet,
ma'am. It's not yet visible.
No, no. Now it's visible.
Yes, ma'am. Now it's all right.
Yeah. Okay, okay. Shall I start?
Yeah, you can start.
Yeah.
Good afternoon to one and all, respected teachers and my dear friends. I, Nivya Unni, research scholar of School of Management Studies, is going to present a paper entitled Range of Cost of Capital in the Companies, a Four-Factor Model Application. Before going to my topic, let me thank the organizers who have given me this opportunity for this presentation. Accurate methods for estimating the cost of equity of a firm is one of the major challenges in the domain of finance. There are different methods for calculating the cost of equity. Sharpe and Miller developed capital asset pricing model, that is CAPM. And CAPM state that expected return from an asset is the sum of the return from risk-free assets and asset market risk premium. The equity market risk premium is simply the difference between expected overall market return and the return from risk-free security. However, research over time found that CAPM is not a complete solution for explaining the cross-sectional variation in expected return. In order to solve this problem, Thomas French in 1993 introduced a multi-factor asset model, that is three-factor model. It expands CAPM by considering size risk factor and value risk factor. Size risk factor means small cap stocks tend to outperform large cap stocks, and value risk factor means value stocks outperform growth stock. However, research for asset pricing model never ends there. In 1993, Jagdish and Pittman documented an anomaly called momentum, and he found that it was possible to increase your earnings by buying stock that was doing well over the last 1 to 6 months and selling stock that were doing badly over the last 1 to 6 months. Carhart four-factor model was proposed by Mark Carhart in 1997. He proposes the addition of a momentum factor to the Farmer-French three-factor model, and it improves the explanatory power of the multi-factor model. Now, the Carhart four-factor model became one of the generally accepted model for asset pricing. Then the rationale for the study is empirical studies in this. Sorry. Studies in this area of pricing model mainly focus identify factors which explain stock return effectively. This is also created new factors of identification. Sorry. Am I audible?
Ma'am, you're audible, but I think there is a small
disturbance.
Okay, just 1 minute.
I request all the participants.
As a result, shall I continue?
Yeah, you can continue.
Okay. As a result, the authors incorporated new factors on asset pricing equation and development of the validity of this model have been tested both in the developed as well as developing market. The study explained the following. The return expectation of the equity shareholders changes over time. The concept in behavior of equity shareholders demands calculation of expected return on equity on a continuous basis. Therefore, the present study is an attempt to estimate the cost of capital of Indian company using Carhartt four factor model. The main objective of this study is to estimate the cost of equity company using the Carhartt four factor model. And the methodology adopted here is the study is descriptive in nature, and the population of interest consisting of all companies whose stocks were quoted in National Stock Exchange, and the final sample consisting of 489 firms after filtering out potential outliers. And the sample period spans from February 2012 to December 2019, and the sampling technique is simple random sampling is used, and secondary source of data is used. Tools for data collection include statistical databases such as CMIE Provost database, websites such as yahoofinance.com, theeconomictimes.com. Data analysis is data is analyzed through the following steps. Here the sample companies were grouped into three sectors, that is primary, secondary, and tertiary, and 14 different industries. And the monthly stock return were computed using monthly equation for monthly stock return. Then the cost of capital is computed as per Carhartt model using the monthly data of risk-free rate, market risk premium, size factor, value factor, and momentum factor. And the data relating to these factors were obtained from Kenneth and Fritz data library for Indian market. And after running ordinary least square regression, coefficients of these factors were obtained. And monthly cost of equity is computed and it converted into annual cost of equity. Then the sector-wise and industry-wise examination of the cost of equity were done using ANOVA. Then moving on to the analysis part, here the results are examined in three sections, overall, sector-wise and industry-wise. Descriptive statistics on cost of equity indicated that the range of cost of equity of Indian companies falls between 0.26% and 28.49%. The average value of cost of equity was 11.35% and standard deviation was 6.12%. Sector-wise analysis is that average cost of equity in the primary sector was 12.70% and then in the secondary sector 12.46% and tertiary sector was 10.96%. Presented that there is no significant differences was formed in the cost of equity of companies in primary, secondary sectors. Then industry-wise analysis result, highest average cost of equity was reported in paper, glass, plastic, technology industry, consumer products and chemical industry. And lowest average cost of equity reported in service industry, banking and finance industry, pharmaceuticals and healthcare industry. And maximum cost of equity reported in chemical industry was 28.49%. Banking and finance industry reported minimum cost of equity 0.38%. Metals and mining industry reported 0.39%. Industry-wise analysis presented cost of equity significantly different industry. The paper estimated the cost of company by sampling 489 companies listed in NSE. The findings have an important implication to the practice in finance managers. Higher cost of equity is an indication of higher expectation from the part of owner. It burdens the financial manager to have a higher investment decision. The higher cost of equity 20% or more, at least in the case of few companies, is also signaling that higher risk associated with market changes. Lower cost of capital in the case of some companies provides a safe zone for their practicing financial manager to exploit investment opportunity of return on investment. These are the references, and thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Nidia, for your presentation. This is you have made a wonderful estimation based on the four-factor model.
And
the objective was also to find out the cost of capital. But I think that will be subsequently coming in your research. Why have you actually studied the cost of capital of these companies? Because it stands out as a single variable. Is it because you want to make a comparison between cost of capital of companies in the primary, secondary, or tertiary sector? Or is it because you wanted to compare cost of capital with the availability of funds in the macroeconomic perspective? Or is it because you wanted to make a comparison between cost and return? Because there is no comparative or relative element that you're talking about. So was there a broader objective of linking this cost with another variable?
Actually, I studied CAPM, Pharma French three-factor model, and Pharma French four-factor model.
Yeah.
For presentation purpose, I extracted only four-factor model.
Yeah, that is fine. That you have wonderfully done. That is accurate and correct. My question is, once you got that figure, what we can understand is, okay, for companies, the cost is this, the primary, the cost is this, the average cost is high for these companies and all. Now the question still remains, why did you actually look at the cost? Is it because you wanted to say that the cost of the companies in the primary sector is high or in one sector is low? Was it a comparison like that you wanted to attempt, or did you have in mind a comparison between cost and returns?
Comparison between primary, secondary, tertiary sector, and comparison between different industries.
Okay, that was attempted. Okay, fine. That's not specifically coming out when you're giving your final findings. Okay, madam.
Yeah, fine. The same question I had. That is it for some broader purpose, or simply she's concentrating on cost of capital?
Okay. Anything else? Anybody else wants to ask, or shall we go to the next presentation? So thank you, Nivya, and wish you all the best. And we go on to the next presentation. This is an empirical analysis on causal relationship between selected macroeconomic variables and the Indian stock market. The study, the paper is by Madam Priyanka from Punjab University, Chandigarh. Over to you, Priyanka.
Hello. Good afternoon, everybody.
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay, sir. Is my screen is visible to you?
Ma'am, it displays.
Now it is visible.
Okay. So I'm Priyanka. I'm working as in guest faculty of commerce and department of evening studies, and also doing my PhD from University Business School, Punjab University, Chandigarh. The topic of my presentation is the empirical analysis of causal relationship between selected macroeconomic variable and Indian stock market. So the stock market, we know, as an action barometer to measure the economic and financial conditions of a country, as it plays a crucial role of conduit between the two divergent ends of the economy, that is one having the surplus of funds and other having the deficit of funds. But the buy and sell decisions of these two ends create demand and supply mechanism. To decide to invest in any security, the investor needs to weigh the information regarding the firm, the general trends in the market, the political and economic environment of the country, so that he can take a decision when to invest and how to invest in stock market returns. If you talk about the theories, one school of thought asserts that fluctuation in stock return are the random walk of the theory, means macroeconomic factor do not influence them, according to Pharma and Geske and Rowley in 1983. While on the other hand, there are researchers who propound that there is a presence of relationship, causal relationship between stock return and few macroeconomic variables, according to King and other researchers, as I have mentioned over here. Now, what is the statement of problem? Why I have selected this particular topic? Now, if you talk about the theories, efficient market hypothesis, capital asset pricing theory, and arbitrage pricing theory, and by Stephen Rose, they suggest that there is a causal relationship between macroeconomic variable and stock trend. However, the theoretical studies and the empirical analysis result somewhere differ according to the various literature that have gone through. Now, complementing the existing literature, the following study will be an attempt to analyze the causal relationship between five macroeconomic variables, that is inflation, exchange rate, industrial production, interest rate, crude oil prices, and the Indian stock market returns. Now, earlier studies, they have largely focused to analyze the relationship from one direction, that is whether macroeconomic variable affects stock market return. There are very few studies, according to my knowledge, that have examined the bi-directional relationship, that whether stock market returns also influences the macroeconomic variable. That gap is going to be covered in this study. So the objective is to analyze the short-term and the long-term causal relationship between the selected variables and the stock market return, Indian stock market return, and to analyze the direction of causality between selected macroeconomic variables and Indian stock return. So the variables that I have chosen, I have already discussed you, but the proxies that I have used for them is, for inflation, I have used consumer price index. For exchange rate, I have used NRI US dollar spot rate, rupees per one foreign currency. For industrial production index, I have described it as composite indicator of short-term changes in volume of production. For interest rate, I have proxied with 91 days treasury bills interest. Crude oil prices has been proxied by petroleum prices measured for Indian rupee per barrel, and return on securities has proxied by the BSE Sensex. Monthly data has been covered from the period of 2013 to 2019 from CMA Economic Outlook database and the database of Indian economy by RBI. And for BSE returns, the data has been taken from BSE official website. Now, I have chosen the time period from 2013 to 2019. There is a reason behind that, because for calculating the consumer price index and industrial index of industrial production, RBI has taken a base year of 2012. So in order to have a symmetry among all the variables, I have taken a time period from 2013. And I have not including 2020 year, because the 2020 year, the stock market were very much influenced by the COVID-19 and the shock that has been there in the market. So I have not included that year. So the time period was 2013 to 2019. Now, here is a data analysis part. I have analyzed the data with the help of, first of all, Johnson co-integration test to analyze that whether there is some kind of long-run causal relationship between them. And the results of the study say that the two variables cannot go in opposite direction for a long period of time. And the results say that there is exist long-term relationship between all the variable and stock return, except in case of industrial production return. Maybe if I have taken a more number of years, maybe the results, maybe some kind of relationship will be there in industrial production index and stock return. And in further analysis, it was found that one vector correlation exists in consumer price index and stock market. And in case of exchange rate, interest rate, and crude oil prices, two vector co-integration exists between the stock market, because the reason may be the inflation changes on a larger time period. I mean, change we can see in inflation on a larger time period, but the exchange rate, interest rate, and crude oil prices are more volatile. So that's why maybe we have the result is there are two factor co-integration between these three variables. And the results were found to be consistent at 5%. And the similar results were consistent with the studies mentioned over here. Then I have used the Granger causality test to check the short-term causal relationship between this variable and stock return, Indian stock return. And the results depicted that the consumer price index, exchange rate, and crude oil prices react to stock market, but there exists only unidirectional relationship. And that relationship flows from these macroeconomic variables to stock returns. But the change in stock return does not affect these variables. And the results were found to be consistent with other studies. Other indexes like index of industrial production, interest rate, do not gradually cause with stock return. And the results were found with consistent with the literature also. The conclusion can be, the results conclude that all variables show long-term co-integration relationship with stock return, ex- except in case of industrial The second section of the study concentrated to analyze the short-term relationship, and the result concludes two variables, that is inflation and exchange rate. Sorry, three variables, inflation, exchange rate, and oil prices show unidirectional causal relationship. The evidence has far-reaching implication for understanding the dynamic relationship between stock market return and macroeconomic variable, and results can be useful for the economist and the policy maker. That's all from my side. Thank you, and I'm open for the questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Priyanka Madam, for your good presentation and what do you call it, a deep level learning into the factorial causal relationship. You have selected a multiple factors, which normally we put in terms of all forms of analysis that could have an impact on stock market indices, like industrial production, forex, exchange rates, or inflation and things like that. One prominent problem is during a period of study, which you have selected, normally these factors have multiple impacts. That means during the same period, there is an impact of inflation, there is an impact of price change and industrial production and all. So they'll all be having cross implications and cross impact. So how will you actually say this is because of this, and this is because of inflation, this is because of exchange rate? This is number one issue. And but for all factors, you said IIP. The index of industrial production did not show a relationship. What could be the reason for that?
Sir, the other factors are more volatile. I mean, we can say crude oil prices, there is more volatility, change on a larger scale.
Okay.
The inflation rate changes and takes time to change. Means the industrial production index, it don't change on a very short period of time. So that may be the reason it has not shown the result. It has not shown the direction of causal relationship.
Okay, fine. And what about the intervening factors? How do you actually, when you're saying one-to-one relation, dependent, independent, what do you do with intervening? Like, there could be the
I have actually not checked the intervening relationship between them. I have just taken the data. I have analyzed that it is a limitation. Maybe I'll work on it and speak with me on that.
Okay, thank you. And madam, anything to add?
Okay, no questions. Good presentation.
Okay, so thank you. All the best, Priyanka. And I think with that, we are going into, if there is no other question from the participants, we are going to the last paper of this track. The paper is titled Effect of Dividend Policy on Financial Performance of BSE 100 Listed Non-Financial Firms. What it is, accounting and market measures. The paper presenter is Gurpreet Kaur, again from Punjab University, Chandigarh. Over to you, Gurpreet.
Very good afternoon to all of you. I'm going to share my screen. Is my screen
visible? Yeah, you're audible. Yeah, you can.
Is my screen visible to you?
Visible.
Thank you, sir. Today, I'm going to present on the effect of dividend policy on financial performance of BSE 100 listed non-financial firms, accounting and market-based measures. Introduction: dividend policy is concerned with financial policies and regarding paying cash dividend in present or paying the increased dividend at a later stage. Financial performance is a subjective measure of how well a firm can use the assets from its primary mode of business and generate the revenues. The term is also used as a general measure of firm's overall financial health over a given period of time. Umpteen factors affect the dividend policy of a firm, such as legal factors, contractual constraints, and political factors, and many more factors like growth of a firm, size of a firm, market orientation, and so on. There are many researches which have shown the effect of dividend payout ratio on the value of a firm and the financial performance, but still the results are inconclusive. This paper contributes to the previously available literature by providing the new insights on the effect of dividend policy on financial performance of a firm using both measures, that is accounting-based measures that are on the basis of financial reports of a company and the market-based measures like the firm value and the share prices of a firm and earning per share, etc. Statement of problem. Previous researchers have focused on analyzing the effect of dividend policy on financial performance only using the accounting based measures. It is only one aspect of analyzing using the internal records only. But as we all know that there is an earning management concept prevalent in the market, and hence the interest of investors is somewhat decreasing in the financial statements of a company due to this biasness. Hence, I'm here using the market-based measures to know whether dividend policy is impacting on the financial performance or not. There are the objectives of my study: impact of dividend payout ratio on firm performance using the accounting-based measure. Accounting-based measure will be proxied by return on assets and return on equity. After it, market-based measures will be gathered with the help of price-earning ratio and Tobin-skew ratio. Research methodology. I'm taking the BSE 100 index as evident from my title itself, and out of this index, I'm choosing only the non-financial firms, and it includes 66 firms. But the reason behind choosing these 66 firms is that the records published by the financial statements and the way to present the financial statements of financial firms is somewhat different from the non-financial firms. Source of data is the CMIE Provis database, as well as the audited balance sheets and reports of the selected non-financial firms. Tools for analysis include descriptive analysis, Carl Pearson's correlation analysis, Osmond test, and panel data regression. These are the variables. For dependent variable, I'm using the financial performance, including four measures, that is return on asset, return on equity, market measures including Tobin-skew and price earning ratio. In the case of independent variable, I'm using the dividend policy and surrogating it with the help of dividend payout ratio. I'm controlling the three variables here, that is the age of the firm, size of the firm, and the growth potential of a particular firm. My research methodology and analysis and discussion of the results include descriptive statistics. The descriptive statistics shows that on an average, firms pay 52% approximately dividend to the investors out of their earnings and retain the 48% of their earnings for future growth opportunities and further investment purposes in a significant way. The average growth rate in sales is 10% with the average price earning ratio 42% approximately. Correlation analysis include the Carl Pearson's correlation analysis, which depict that price earning ratio has a significant relationship with dividend payout ratio, and this is highly correlated with it. ROA has a significant positive correlation with growth and size. Size and price earning ratio are also correlated significantly. Dividend payout ratio is negatively correlated with ROA, ROE, and Tobin-skew and growth, and is positively related to the size and price earning ratio of these firms. This is the panel data analysis table, which is depicting here that Osmond test is showing less than 0.05 value for ROA and more than 0.05 value for ROE, Tobin-skew, and PE ratio. This depicts that I should use the fixed effect model in panel data regression for return on assets, and for other variables, I should use the random effect model, and I'm doing the same. And for this, I can say here that the coefficient of determination for ROA and PE ratio, that is 92% and 79% respectively, are showing the highest impact on the dividend payout ratio. And other two are non-significant as depicted by the p-value F statistics here. So the conclusions and suggestions of my study is, as I already said that I'm using the 5-year data in, and I'm using the eView software for analysis purpose. The results show that ROA and PE ratio has a greater influence on dividend policy rather than ROE and Tobin-skew. The best relation evaluated from this study is of PE ratio and DPR. best relation evaluated from this study is PE ratio and DPR, which shows a significant positive correlation and high impact through the coefficient of determination. And best fitted model with the help of p-value, that is significant at 99% level. The dividend policy has a significant impact on the ROA and PE ratio. And the further studies, financial firms can also be taken in order to reduce the limitation of this research, and leverage can also be taken as a control variable to depict accurately that what is the impact of dividend policy on the financial performance of firm. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Gurpreet. A good study on dividend policy and the rates at which it is having. What was the period for which the data was actually taken, and how did you cover dividend policy? Like how many dividend issues took place during that period?
Actually, sir, I'm covering the data period of 2015 to 2019, and I have taken the dividend payout ratio surrogating the dividend policy.
Okay, fine, good. So thank you, and madam, anything you would like to add?
Yeah, the same analysis, same kind of analysis you would have conducted for a particular sector, industrial sector, okay? Then it would have been more, meaningful, because you could have compared the dividend policy of two different sectors, companies of two different sectors, like that.
I will definitely do in future.
Yeah.
Already you have your 100 with you, BSC 100, so that you can classify into sector and you can make a comparative analysis.
You can make sectoral comparisons.
Yeah. So I think with that, okay, we have completed the 10 papers in track A for this. And we were supposed to start at 10 o'clock and complete by 12 o'clock, but we started at 10:30 and now it is 12:40. So maybe 10 minutes we have exceeded. So first of all, towards the end, I thank all the paper presenters. Almost all the papers were of good quality and with interpretation, with research implications, with use of good databases like eViews, Yahoo, Finance.com, as well as Prowess of CMI. So a lot of effort taken by all the presenters. I thank you all for all the 10 presenters for your good work and wish you all the very best. What has come out from this is basically how we are using our literature to extend it beyond, and how we are using our data outputs in terms of interpretation and inferences. And I think it gives us a lot of inputs, a lot of food for thought on what others can take as deliverables or outcomes from this. And I'm sure all those participants would be interested in having lots of association on similar kind of work that they can take home. And that is where we will enrich our research outcomes from our own research center. So I thank you all for your support and your efforts in giving you your research outcomes. Wish you all the very best in your research prospects for future. I also take this opportunity to thank my co-chair, Professor Hemal Pandya from Gujarat University, who has given very vital inputs on how to further strengthen papers, for her time, for her efforts and energy in giving more life to this session. I thank the organizers also for giving me this opportunity. And before we actually conclude, I hand over the session to Dr. Hemal Pandya for final conclusion.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much to the Kerala University, especially Dr. Biju A.V. sir, for inviting me to chair this session. I found it very interesting and very good efforts from all the participants. Just one general comment for those who have made the studies on causality. Okay, I suggest that you just extend your research to building up the model, searching for an appropriate model, validating it and using it for forecasting or predictions. So that will be a complete package, so far as the time series models are concerned, fine? Because the ultimately the basic purpose of all the econometric models, it is going for predictions and projections, fine? So just don't stop at the causality studies, extend them up to forecasting, fine? So that would be more extension of the research in the complete sense, okay? Otherwise, all the papers were good, were very nicely presented by all the participants. Congratulations to all of them. And again, all the best to all of them for pursuing their further research. Thanks to all, thanks to the management especially, and thanks to my senior chairperson, to all of
wish you all good and enjoy the first. Thanks, sir.
Thank you, and over to the audience.
Thank you, Hemal ma'am, and thank you, Simon sir. I would like to thank once again to the chairs, Professor Simon Tatil from Kerala University and Professor Hemal Pandya from Gujarat University for the excellent comments to the presenters. And I would also like to thank the 10 presentations we have. Majority presentations comes out by using time series and panel models. I hope the presenters are enjoyed and the participants also have got many value additions from this session. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you, participants. And over to you, host.
A very big thank you to Professor Dr. Gabriel Simon Tatil and Dr. Hemal Pandya. In total, we had 10 paper presentations and all of them looked into various aspects of finance. Both our chairs have taken a great strain in going through the papers, listening to the presentation, and giving valuable suggestions. Dr. Gabriel Simon Tatil, Professor of Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, has always made it a point to attend all the programs hosted by the department. His suggestion has not only benefited today's paper presenters, but also for all the other participants during the presentation. On behalf of our department, we thank you, sir, for such an amazing chairing. Dr. Hemal Pandya, his co-chair, is also a very well-renowned statistician. She has spared her valuable time online all the way from Gujarat. Her suggestions to the presenters have been a great source of guidance and motivation for presenting more and more papers. On behalf of the Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, we thank you, ma'am, for your esteemed presence and valuable suggestions.
Thank you to both the chairs and thanks to all the paper presenters for your wonderful presentations. I thank Ms. Kartika R., the Research Scholar, Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, for managing the track A. Delegates, that's an end to the first track. Let's take a lunch break and be back right here at 1:15 p.m. for the second track.
Thank you all.
Thanks to all.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah.